Hello, this video is a demonstration of the Boss DE200, which is a digital delay rack mount effects unit manufactured by Boss in 1983, I believe, according to the manual. And I'll just take you through the controls we've got on the front panel here first. We've got a power switch here. We've got an input jack on the front. There's also one on the back. We've got an output jack on the front, and there's also one on the back of that as well. Then we've got a bypass switch here. That is not a true bypass. If you've got the machine powered down, it doesn't work. So you wouldn't want to use that. It will suck some tone out of your signal, probably. Then we've got an input level gain control here with a meter above it so that you know if you're distorting or not by looking at that. We've got a delay time here, and we've got a coarse control here, which is on a clicker switch. And then we've got a fine delay time control here, which will take you from half of the time here. So we've got 640, so that would be half of 640, 320, all the way up to the 640 listed on there. And between all of these, you'll be able to get any delay time you want between the 1.5 milliseconds all the way up to 640 milliseconds. Here you've got a switch, a mode switch, they call it. And what that does is it doubles the sample time and halves the sample rate. Because this is a digital delay unit, you can do that. So the sample rate on this unit as standard is about 10k, up to 10k, and it sounds quite clean. But if you engage this, it brings it down to 4.5 kilohertz, according to the manual, and it will bring your delay time up to 1.3, 1.28, roughly, 1.28 seconds, that is. So it's not got too much sample time, but it is a fairly early unit. Here we've got a hold switch, which can do all kinds of interesting things, which I'll describe once we get the unit plugged in. We've got a modulation section on here, which is an LFO, which controls the fine tune, basically. So you can use that to dial in all kinds of weird and wonderful effects. You can do flanges, choruses, that kind of stuff. And we've got a time and a depth control for that. We've got feedback here, so you can have it just repeat once, or you can take it all the way up till self feedback and you'll just get noise coming out of it at the end. There's a phase switch here for the output signal, so you can invert the phase on the delayed signal if you want to do that for any reason. And here we've got a little mixer where we've got a dry and wet signal here so that you can set your levels like that find the mix that you want. Okay, I'll just turn the unit round now and then we'll have a look at the back. Right, okay, we can see some of the sockets on the back of the unit now. Here we've got a kettle lead socket here. If you've got an American one, it's a different socket, but it's got an internal power supply, this. It's not got an AC adapter. Here you've got a switch for the power supply, which I believe you can set to 240, 220, 110 and 100, so pretty much wherever you are in the world, the same unit should work as long as you've got a lead that will fit in it. We've got rhythm sync here. We've got a foot switch socket and a trigger in socket, and they can do all kinds of interesting stuff, which I'll get onto later on once we've got the unit powered up. We've got a remote section here, which is just for pedals to control the hold on and off and to bypass the unit, which would be quite useful if you're a guitarist. You can use a pedal for that. We've got the output here. We've got the inverted mix, which I believe is just phase inverted. We've got the output mix, which is exactly the same as the output socket on the front. And we've got a direct here, which I think just feeds you the dry signal, but I'm not certain on that. It might just be the wet signal, but it's called direct anyway. And then we've got an input jack on the back, which again is exactly the same as the one on the front. Okay, let's power it up. Right, okay, we've got the unit powered up now, and I've got the Slim Fatty plugged into it. We've just got a really basic patch here, and I'll play it first bypassed for you. And then I'll turn it on for you here. So there you go. You can hear the sound of the unit there. It's not pristine. It is a bit dirty, but it's not bad for the age of the unit. So let's just have a little fiddle here. If we turn up the feedback amount slightly, then we'll play again. Okay, and you can hear there, you can get it to decay for quite a long time. I'll play quickly just with it for a bit, and then I'll show you this phase invert switch, because that can be used, I'm sure it's designed for technical purposes, but it can also just change the sound slightly, so... There you go, there's that. What else can we do here? Oh yeah, I'll turn up the delay so that you can hear the maximum delay time we've got. I'll change the patch on here just so that you can hear it more obviously, rather than this one with the slow attack. Okay, let's try this. So, there we have it. I'll just turn it down again. There's a feedback and you'll just hear it once. So it is quite a clean unit, really. The sound is quite clean. I'll turn it up now. I'll change it to mode 2. This will double the delay time, but half the sample rate. So you can hear there, it's not as crisp, you lose some of the high frequencies, but it does still work, you could use it. So let's just fiddle now with the modulation a little bit so that you can just see what that does. So I'll just change the patch again. Okay, so we'll just put in some modulation now. So we'll dial up the rate slightly and we'll dial up the depth. If I turn down the direct signal there, you can hear much better what it's doing. Just turn it back to normal there. Now, all that that modulation section is controlling is the delay time here, so I can mimic the effect if I just do this. So, there you go, you've got that. So you've got your classic delays there. We can also dial in kind of slapback delay kind of sounds. If I just turn it up there, there we go. obviously a synth is probably not the best thing to demonstrate. You'd prefer a vocalist, probably. You'd prefer Elvis, ideally. But there you go. You can hear how that works. And I'll just show you the hold here. But before I do that, I'll just connect a different synth. Right, okay. So I now have the Juno 60 plugged in, and we've got a pad on that. I'll just play that for you. And we've got a bit of delay applied there, but now I'm going to show you the hold circuit on this, or the hold function. So we set it to the maximum delay time here so that I can capture the full 640 milliseconds. Turn the feedback down, and I'll just set it going on here. Right, so there we go. We've got that sampled in there now. You can see we've got nothing coming in the input. We can still play the Juno, but we're not using it at the moment, so we'll turn that back up again. And we can change the pitch on that with the delay time. And if we play with the delay course control, then we can do some tricks with that as well. And if you take it up to the really short delay times, the 40, 30, 10 milliseconds kind of thing, then you'll see that you start to lose the pitch of it. So we've got that, and now I'll show you we can half that as well, to downsample basically, to pitch it down by half. And that effectively drops it down an octave, because it halves the, or it doubles the sample time, it doubles the length, and it halves the pitch. So there we go, we've got the basic functions there sorted, but there's quite a lot that you can do with the modulation if you set them up properly. So what I'll do now is I'll just go through some different kind of sounds of choruses, kind of or pseudo chorus kind of flange sounds, that kind of thing, and I won't talk over them anymore. You'll just be able to hear it. Thank you. Right, so hopefully there you get an idea of the range of sounds that you can get out of this unit, from just standard delays, slapback style delays, all the way up to kind of modulated flange effects and pseudo chorus effects. So what I'll do now is I'll talk about some of the more advanced features of the unit. Now, on the back, as you saw at the start, there's sockets, and you can plug a pedal into them just to trigger, I think, the hold here. You can trigger that with a pedal and also the bypass. And obviously that makes sense if you are a guitarist on stage. You can't be reaching across and pressing buttons with your hands because you're busy. So a pedal's good for that. But I'll not bother demonstrating that for you because that's fairly straightforward. What I will demonstrate is we've got two more advanced features on this unit, or three really, but two useful ones. The first of those is being able to clock the delay time to a rhythm machine. So you'll notice here on top that I've got a drum machine here. It's a Roland TR-707. And the TR-707 has a trigger output on it for clocking to other devices. And the Boss DE-200 is one such device which can clock to this signal. So what it does is it clocks delay times to the rim shot output, or the trigger output tied to the rim shot. So I'll just play this here. And there you can hear the rim shot. I've got that muted in the actual tune because you don't want to have to listen to it when it's triggering it. But there I've got it on 16th notes, and I've got a patch here on the Juno, which I'll just play for you now. So you can hear that there, just kind of a kind of standard sequencer style bass patch. But if I play them both together, then you'll note that the Juno is clocked to the 707. I'll just do that for you now. Right, okay, so there you go, you get the basic idea with that. And now that's not particularly impressive, because you can obviously just dial in the time yourself. The benefit of using this method is that it's quite easy to switch tempos and keep your delay time the same. So I'll just do that now. So we had it there, 108. Then we can dial it up to, say, 100 and what have we got here, 117. And there we have it. So that works. You do get some glitches if you try and change the tempo while it's running, but you could do that as well. But the other benefit of this is that you can change quickly between... So we've got 16th notes here, but if we change to this patch, or this pattern rather, we'll play that. And you can even do more irregular patterns. So here, this on this patch, we've got dialed in a more kind of random sequence. So it's not regular. So if I play that and then I dial up the feedback here, and you'll be able to hear it. I'll just press the key once just so that you know what's going on at the keyboard, and then you'll be able to hear what's happening. So there you go, that's the rhythm sync, and it works quite well. It means that you can play stuff live that you would definitely not be able to play sequenced. It's not going to sound perfect as if it was sequenced, but it is a viable option. I'll just play something for you now so you get the idea. So there you go. It's simple stuff, but you can hear how it works. And I don't know if you heard that, but there's still weird little gremlins in the system when you try and run it like this. So there you heard just a sample from ages ago. But there we go. That's that. But there's also one extra mode in this, which is really quite exciting for the time, and that is a sampler mode. So you can actually sample in sounds and trigger them with the rim shot, and I'll set it up so that we can demonstrate that now. Okay, so there we go. We've got the sample mode ready now, and the way that you prepare that is by plugging in the pedal to one of the inputs on the back. That's for triggering the sampling. And then we've also got the TR-707 trigger output still tied on there. And then we use that to trigger the sample once we've got it in there. So at the moment, I've got the drum tracks here, just as an example, because of the limited sample time, really. You can do technically half bar samples at 4.5 kilohertz sampling time at about roughly 120 beats per minute. But really, I think that in the manual it says that this is just for drums, and it works well for drums, so we use drums for this, just for this demonstration. So here we go, we've got the drum tracks plugged in here. And what I'll do now is I'll try to sample that. Now, this is a bit of a trial and error thing, because you have to press the pedal and the sample and the drum pad at exactly the same time for it to sample. So I might not get it right the first time, let's see how we go. Okay, that might have worked. You then arm it ready to play by pressing the hold button, and let's press start and see what happens. There we have it, it's working. And that's not the 707 snare, that is the snare from this, and I'll prove that. Now we'll change the pitch a bit. So there you go, you can see that does actually work quite nicely, actually. I'll sample in a clap now, just so that we can see how it sounds with that instead. Press that button there, and that enables you to sample again. Although, like I say, then you get some weird glitches when you try and sample. I think sometimes it plays the sound that you've just sampled, so. We'll just make sure the pitch is right. We set it in the middle there, then that means we're able to pitch it down as well as up once we've sampled it. And okay, that should be ready now. I'll try and sample the clap. Right, let's try. So there you have it, that works quite nicely. As well as that, as well as the trigger feature and the sampling feature, there is a feature within this to do a kind of sound-on-sound thing, almost like a loop pedal. Now, I could demonstrate that, but really, given that it's the maximum sampling time is 1.3 seconds, so your loop's going to have to be 1.3 seconds. I thought, what's the point in bothering? These two effects, though, actually do work nicely. And so there you go. You get a good idea of this unit here. It's got a lot of extra features. And the thing to remember, I think, is for 1983, this is really quite advanced stuff. I mean, this is pre-MIDI, and really, if I know it can only sample half a second if you want decent sample rate quality, but for 1983, you'd have to go and buy a Synclavier or a Fairlight if you wanted to sample. So you could get a few of them, one for a kick, one for a snare, one for a hi-hat. You could theoretically do some sampling of drums and get it to work quite nicely. There we have it, the Boss DE200. So it is a good unit, but there is one flaw with it, which you've not seen in this video particularly, but which you might notice if you got one of these. And that is that it is designed primarily for the guitarist. If you are a guitarist, not a problem. It's a good unit. But if you're trying to use line level signals with it, like I am, synthesizer outputs and then sending the output back into a mixing desk, you will find that it's very easy to overdrive the input because it's designed for a guitar preamplification, so a very low level signal. And also that the output is very low because it's designed to go into an amp rather than into a mixing desk. Now, these are problems that can be overcome by a modification conceived by Don Solaris, I believe is how you pronounce his name, and he's posted information about it on Gear Sluts, and I've put the link in the description. And this is exactly the modification I've done to this unit, and you can see me in the background there messing about with it. And following the modification, I found that I was definitely able to drive the input much harder. I didn't really notice too much of a difference with the output, but I didn't subject myself to scientific tests, so I'm not certain, but I'm sure it made some difference, the output as well. So that's about everything. That is the Boss DE200 digital delay unit. If you've got any questions at all about this or anything else that I've used in this video, then just drop a comment down below. And that's it. Cheers for watching. Bye.